فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
وما العبادة التي أمر الله بها مثل الإسلام والإيمان والإحسان، ومنها الدعاء والخوف والرجاء والتوكل والرغبة والرهبة والخشوع والخشية والإنابة والاستعانة والاستعاذة والاستغاثة والذبح والنذر وغير ذلك من أنواع العبادة التي أمر الله بها، كلها لله تعالى. والدليل قوله تعالى: وأن المساجد لله فلا تدعوا مع الله أحدا. فمن صرف منها شيئا لغير الله فهو مشرك كافر. والدليل قوله تعالى: ومن يدع مع الله إلها آخر لا برهان له به فإنما حسابه عند ربه إنه لا يفلح الكافرون.
The author رحمه الله, after telling us and explaining to us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who deserves to be worshipped, the author now moves to speaking about the reality of ibadah. And the way he chose to speak about the reality of ibadah is by giving us the types of ibadah there is. As the scholars, they say, وَبِالْمِثَالِ يَتَّضِحُ الْمَقَالِ. With an example, things become clear. But the way that the author chose to give the examples or tell the types of ibadat there is, he categorized and he divided the ibadat in the typings that he's going to give it in two. فَذَكَّرَ أَنْوَاعًا مِنَ الْعِبَادَةِ الْمَأْمُورِ بِهَا إِجْمَالًا وَتَفْصِيلًا. The author, he mentions the types of ibadat and he categorized it into two. The first one is, he mentions ibadat which are general. فَذَكَرَ أَنْوَاعًا مِنَ الْعِبَادَةِ الْمَأْمُورِ بِهَا إِجْمَالًا وَتَفْصِيلًا. The first one is إِجْمَالًا. The first one is إِجْمَال, comprehensive, generic. And he mentioned three there. الْإِيمَانُ وَالْإِسْلَامُ وَالْإِحْسَانُ. That's three types of ibadah, but they're very general. They're very generic. Are you with me, brothers? Then the second one is, he mentions وَتَفْصِيلًا, detailed, specific types of ibadat. And he mentions from them الدُّعَاء وَالْخَوْفُ وَالرَّجَاءُ وَالتَّوَكُّلُ وَالرَّغْبَةُ وَالرَّهْبَةُ وَالْخُشُوعُ وَالْخَشْيَةُ وَالْإِنَابَةُ وَالْإِسْتِعَانَةُ وَالْإِسْتِعَاذَةُ وَالْإِسْتِغَاثَةُ والذبح والنذر. All of those are specific. The author rahimahullah, he then clarifies all of those types, whether it is the anwa' which are mujmala, the generic type, or those which are the specific types, all are for who? Kulluha lillahi, all of them are for Allah. And he brings qawluhu ta'ala, وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ فَلَا تَدْعُ مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. Where is the dalala? And how is he trying to extract evidence from this verse? He's extracting it from this verse مِنْ وَجْهَيْنِ, from two different. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab brought an ayah. What's the dalala? How is he trying to extract the ruling from the verse? He is extracting it from min wajhaini, from two different faces, from two different angles. The first one is wa anna al masajida lillahi, is that the masajid are for Allah. That the masajid are for who? They are for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second one is فَلَا تَدْعُ مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. Don't worship anybody with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in it. Because the first part of the ayah means وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ. What is the masajid? A place of what? It's a place of worship. So the first part of the ayah is as though it's saying to you اُعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَاشِفَ اللَّهِ. And the next part فَلَا تَدْعُ مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا is saying to you وَلَا تَعْبُدُ the worship مَعَهُ أَحَدًا anyone with him. The first one is telling you that the masajid, and what's the masajid built for? When the man came into the masjid, the Bedouin, and he urinated in the masjid, and the Sahabas came and they ran at him. And some of the scholars, they stated the reason why the Bedouin came and urinated in the Prophet's masjid is because the Prophet's masjid was not built in a way that the Bedouin could tell where the masjid started from and where it ended. And this is a reality that we have to understand. It's not about the construction and the building of a masjid. If it's built, فَنِعِمَّهِ blessing is it. It's good. But the Prophet's masjid produced the best of people and the best of generations. And a Bedouin couldn't tell where the masjid of Prophet had the structure, where is it, toilet or not. So he came and you urinated in the Prophet's masjid. When he urinated, the Prophet ﷺ commanded for a bucket to be brought, he poured it onto the... And he taught the man, the Bedouin man, he said to him, this place that you see right now is the house of Allah. لا يصلح فيه, it is not correct to do what you did in it. إنما بني, the Prophet said, it was built, it was made for what? بالصلاتي was, you know, with dhikr. The salah and the remembrance of Allah. So the masjid was built for this to be done. This masjid of the Prophet that you're looking at now, or you're thinking about now, or that is being spoken about now, is that masjid that from it they conquered Mashariq al-Ardi wa Magharibiha, the east and the west. They conquered it. There's a saying, Inna al-Arda la yuqaddisu sakiniha, a land does not honor its people. Just because you're from Mecca, that doesn't mean you're honorable. There was a time when Mecca was a land that the Prophet and his companions were told to do hijrah from it. إِنَّ الْأَرْضَ لَا يُقَدِّسُ سَاكِنِهَا. Are you with me, brothers? What is it that honors you? Your amal and your actions. A masjid should be done khayr, and that's what it was built for. Da'wah and khayr and dhikr is what it's built for, whether it's beautiful or whether it's not. There are some masajid that are beautifully built and they're doing khayr and dhikr and everything. Amazing. They combine between two goods. And there are some masajid when you go to it, it's become a museum. It's a museum. Go to Turkey right now. The masjid is a museum. Go to Egypt, Azhar. It's a museum. Women are walking in there with their shoes in the masjid. Kuffar walking around. I'm not talking about whether it's permissible to enter the kuffar into the masjid. It is permissible to bring them into the masjid. But it's become a museum. Wow. How this masjid has been built for 200 years. Wow. This is where the masjids were built for that. They were not built for that. استحوذ عليهم الشيطان فأنساهم ذكر الله. Shaytan whispered to them, tricked them and fooled them, and they forgot the remembrance of Allah. So that's the two dalala that he's trying to take from it. That the masjid is built for Allah's worship. One. Second is, فَلَا تَدْعُ مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. So if the masjid was built for ibadah, he established that muqaddimah. It's ibadah why it was built. فَلَا تَدْعُ مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا means don't do other than ibadah for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the author rahimahullah says, فَبَضْ صَرَفَ. This word he used, صَرَفَ. We chose it's not a good usage, right? When he said, جَعَل is better. The word جَعَل to use it is correct. And we mentioned yesterday for two reasons why it's better. Then the author brings قوله تعالى, the statement of Allah, فَمَنْ صَرَفَ, sorry, مِنْهَا شَيْئًا لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ, anyone who diverts ibadah for other than Allah, فَهُوَ مُشْرِكٌ كَافِرٌ. When he says شَيْئًا, anything, he means the ibadat that he mentioned, the tafsil ibadah, whether it be dua, al-khawf, wal-raja, wal-raghba, wal-rahba, wal-tawakul, wal-inaba, all of them. I didn't mention them because it's going to come to us, each one. Each one, what they mean, and with their delil is going to come. Any one of those, anyone who diverts it. What did the author say? فَوَ مُشْرِكٌ كَافِرٌ. The sheikh doesn't just bring it from his pocket. Straight away he tells you the delil for that. The delil for that is what? وَمَنْ يَدْعُ مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَٰهًا آخَرَ لَا بُرْهَانَ لَهُ بِهِ فَإِنَّمَا حِسَابُهُ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِ إِنَّهُ لَا يُفْلِحُ الْكَافِرُونَ. Again, it's easy to bring an ayah. But what is the wajhu dalala? What is the what? The wajhu dalala. How have you extracted this ruling from the ayah? Amma, why has he brought this ayah? How is he trying to prove what he's just said? Again, the wajhu dalala murakkabun min amrayni, is compounded from two things. He's using it with these two points. Ahaduhuma, the first one is, Allah mentions an action mutawa'adun alayhi, which in it is a severe warning. Allah says, وَمَنْ يَدْعُ مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَٰهًا آخَرَ, anyone who worships with Allah a ilah, لَا بُرْهَانَ لَهُ بِهِ, there's no proof for you. So if you worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you have no proof, no hujjah. لَا بُرْهَانَ لَهُ بِهِ. مَا مَعْنَا لَا بُرْهَانَ إِلَىٰ حُجَّةَ لَهُ بِهِ. You have no proof for this. You can't argue on this. So every quburi who says, I have evidences for this, we say to him, لَا لا برهان له به. You have no proof for this. Allah told us. There's no hujjah for you in this. This is not صريح النص. The sheikh is taking it from the lazim of the nas. The second is, so the first one was this action of yours, لا برهان له به. The second one is توعد بالحساب مع بيان المآل. Allah is promising you that He's going to account you for this. And that your final abode is going to be severe. Allah says, إِنَّهُ لَا يُفْلِحُ الْكَافِرُونَ فَإِنَّمَا حِسَابُ. First Allah says, you're going to be accounted for this claim of yours. And this action that you've just come with, you're going to be accounted for it severely. And also, the hellfire is going to be your abode. Because you are a kafir. So this action shows that it's kufr. فَإِنَّهُ لَا يُفْلِحُ الْكَافِرُونَ, that the disbelievers are not successful. نعم.
وفي الحديث الدعاء مخ العبادة والدليل قوله تعالى وقال ربكم ادعوني أستجب لكم إن الذين يستكبرون عن عبادتي سيدخلون جهنم داخلين. ودليل الخوف قوله تعالى فلا تخافوهم وخافوني إن كنتم مؤمنين. ودليل الرجاء قوله تعالى فمن كان يرجو لقاء ربه فليعمل عملا صالحا ولا يشرك بعبادة ربه أحدا. ودليل التوكل قوله تعالى وعلى الله فتوكلوا إن كنتم مؤمنين. وقوله ومن يتوكل على الله فهو حسبه. ودليل الرغبة والرهبة والخشوع قوله تعالى إنهم كانوا يسارعون في الخيرات ويدعوننا رغبا ورهبا وكانوا لنا خاشعين. ودليل الخشة قوله تعالى فلا تخشوهم واخشوني. ودليل الإنابة قوله تعالى وأنيبوا إلى ربكم وأسلموا له. ودليل الاستعانة قوله تعالى إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين. وفي الحديث إذا استعنت فاستعن بالله ودليل الاستعادة قوله تعالى قل أعوذ برب الفلق وقل أعوذ برب الناس ودليل الاستغاثة قوله تعالى إذ تستغيثون ربكم فاستجاب لكم ودليل الذبح قوله تعالى قل إن صلاتي ونسكي ومحياي وماتي لله رب العالمين لا شريك له ومن السنة لعن الله من ذبح لغير الله ودليل النذر قوله تعالى يوفون بالنذر ويخافون يوما كان شره مستطيرا.
The author رحمه الله, he now goes into the anwa'ul ibadah, which we called it what? At-tafsiliyah, the tafsili, detailed ones. The ones he did with tafsil, detailed. He's now going into them. The author brought 14 evidences. He brought 14 of them. If you look at the types there are, how many types did he mention? If you count them, there are 14 types. 14 types of ibadah that he mentions. And he mentions 16 evidences. Fourteen of them are ayat, and two of them are hadith. 14 of them are ayat, and two of them are hadith. The two hadith he brings is إِذَا اسْتَعَنْتَ فَاسْتَعِنْ بِاللَّهِ, and the hadith لَعَنَ اللَّهُ مَنْ ذَبَحَ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ. The first one is narrated by Tirmidhi bin Hadith bin Abbas بِسَنَدٍ حَسَنٍ, and the second one is narrated by Muslim in his Sahih bin Hadith Ali bin Abi Talib. And the author started with the 14 that he put. The 14 that he mentioned, he started with الدُّعَى. He started off with that. And the author said, وَفِي الْحَدِيثِ الدُّعَى مُخُّ الْعِبَادَةِ, that the dua is مُخُّ الْعِبَادَةِ. And scholars have graded this hadith to be weak. Some scholars have defended him and they said, a Shaykh Muhammad Abdul Wahab, they said he wasn't using this hadith as evidence. He was using this hadith as a heading for dua. And you are allowed to use a weak narration as a heading if the meaning is correct, as long as you don't attribute it to who? As long as you don't attribute it to the Prophet. Others have said that the nuskhas they mention were fil hadithi, and the urf of the word hadith means that the Prophet ﷺ has said it. Ala kulli hal, it is weak narration. لا يصح عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. But what is authentically transmitted from him that he said الدُّعَاء هو العبادة. That الدُّعَاء is عبادة. Then the author رحمه الله, he went into explaining dua. And the reason why he started with dua is because dua is the head of all of the matter. Ra'suha. And when you're starting with something, you should always try to start bil ahammi, with that which is most important. And the author brings the evidence, which is وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ ادْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي سَيَدْخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ دَاخِرِينَ. The dua in the sharia has two meanings. The dua in the sharia, has two meanings. Ahaduhuma, the first one is amun, general meaning. وهو امتثال خطاب الشرع المقترن بالحب والخضوع. The first one is امتثال خطاب الشرع المقترن بالحب والخضوع. The first one is surrendering and submitting to imtithal khitab al-shara, the things that the sharia addresses you with. Al-muqtarini bil-hubbi wal-khudu', doing it in a state of complete humiliation and complete love. And we mentioned the line of poetry. We mentioned previously, وَعِبَادَةُ الرَّحْمَنِ غَايَةُ حُبِّهِ وَخُضُوعِ قَاصِدِهِ هُمَا قُطْبَانِ وَعِبَادَةُ الرَّحْمَنِ غَايَةُ حُبِّهِ وَخُضُوعِ قَاصِدِهِ هُمَا قُطْبَانِ. We mentioned that. That you're worshipping Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, you're following His addressing with complete love and complete humiliation. That's the generic and the general meaning. Some scholars, they call it du'a'ul ibadah. They call it what? Du'a'ul ibadah. The first time it's called du'a'ul ibadah. Basically, every single act of the religion that you do is a du'a. Have you guys come to this class today? Brothers, have you guys come to this class today? This is a du'a that you guys have just done. How? When you came here, what were you hoping from Allah? Yeah, a reward, right? You're asking Allah for a reward, right? Brothers, aren't you? That's the generic meaning. Everything in the religion is a du'a from this angle. Salah is a du'a. Sawm is a du'a. Zakat is a du'a. Hajj is a du'a. Learning the religion is a du'a. That's the generic meaning. Sah? Are you with me, brothers? The second one is called khas. And it is talabul abdi. Alhamdulillah. Yahdikum Allah wa yuslih balakum. The second one is dua, which is khas. And it is talabul abdi that the slave asks. Min rabbihi, from his Lord. حصول ما ينفعه ودوامه أو دفع ما يضره ورفعه. The second one is طلب العبد من ربه. You're requesting, the slave is requesting from his Lord, حصول ما ينفعه ودوامه, asking for that which will benefit you and allowing it to be consistent for you and for it to remain for you. أو دفع ما يضره, أو دفع ما يضره ورفعه, or repelling from you and removing from you anything that's going to bring about harm to you. And this one is called دعاء المسألة. It's known as what? دعاء المسألة. Every dua that we make like this, Allahumma ighfir lana, Allahumma arhamna, that type of dua is the common one that people understand the word dua to be. Are you with me, brothers? This is called dua al-mas'ala. It's the dua of asking. Mas'ala. Every time you make supplication and a dua, you're only asking for one or two. Nothing else you could be asking for. You're either asking Him to bring a good about for you, and that's what you want to attain, or you're asking Him to remove a harm from you. Sah? Is there anything else you'd be asking for? That's what dua al-mas'ala is. Both of them, dua al-ibadah, which is the dua which is am, and dua al-mas'ala, which is khas, both of them you can't divert it for anybody other than Allah. Are you with me? And that qawluhu ta'ala, وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمُ ادْعُونِي. Udu'uni here encompasses the ma'ana al-'am and the ma'ana which is khas. Astajib lakum. Innal ladhina yastakbiruna 'an ibadati sayadkhuluna jahannama dakhirin. Ma ma'ana dakhirin? Allah is saying in this verse, wa qala rabbukum udu'uni. Your Lord says to me, your Lord says to you, wa qala rabbukum udu'uni. Supplicate to me, ask me, worship me. Astajib lakum. I will accept it from you. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ, those who are expressing arrogance. سَيَدْخُلُونَ, they will enter جَهَنَّم. سَيَدْخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ. مَا مَعْنَى دَاخِرِينَ? دَاخِرِينَ means صَاغِرِينَ. أَذِلِّينَ. They will enter hellfire humiliated, belittled, disgraced. It means صَاغِرِينَ. أذلين. So imagine you're entering the hellfire with that you're being humiliated. By the way, you're going to enter the hellfire. How do you enter the hellfire? Heads in. No one's going to even let you walk. You're going to be grabbed. And you're going to be thrown in like that. No qima for you. Why? Because the one who gave you all of that which you have in this universe today, who allowed you to breathe, who gave you children, health, and everything which you have, you forgot him, you dismissed him, and you worshipped other than him. Today, there is nothing else you deserve except humiliation and disgrace. There was a time Allah honored you and gave you this world and made the world around you humiliated for you. But today, you failed the test. You failed the test, the real test. There is no other rights that you deserve and no other thing you deserve except Jahannam for it to be your abode. Some people will say to you, brothers, God, why does he scare us with the hellfire? Why does he... Huh? Be pushed out. These people have misunderstood. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for him to even enter us into Jannah is mercy. There was no other way we could have made it to Jannah. Are you with me? Because every good that you've come with, Allah has already fully rewarded you in this world for it. However much you worship Allah, your eyesight alone is worth more than all the obedience that you're coming with. So you will always come the Day of Judgment short if Allah doesn't add on to His mercy for you. So there wasn't a time, you did not reach a point where you deserve Jannah. You don't deserve Jannah. That's why the Prophet ﷺ said, لَنْ يَدْخُلَ أَحَدُكُمُ الْجَنَّةَ بِعَمَلِهِ. That no one's going to enter Jannah because of his actions. No one. The Sahabas, they said, قِيلَ وَلَا أَنْتَ. Even you, O Messenger of Allah, قَالَ وَلَا أَنَا. Even me. I won't enter Jannah because of my actions. إِلَّا أَنْ يَتَغَمَّدَ لِلَّهُ بِرَحْمَةِ مِنْهُ وَفَضْلًا. Except Allah, تبارك وتعالى. The actions are needed. The actions are what's going to open the discussion in the first place. But they're not enough to take you to Jannah. Allah's mercy is what takes you to Jannah. You never deserved it. وَلِذَلِكَ the Prophet ﷺ said there's going to be if a slave was born, and from the day he was born, he was dragged on the face of this earth. Dragged on the face of this earth. His face was dragged on the ground. From the day he was born to the day he dies. For the sake of Allah. When he comes the Day of Judgment, he will belittle that. He will what? He will belittle that. There are angels, brothers, who were created in sujood. Since the day Allah created them, they're in sujood. That's the state Allah created them in. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the trumpet is blown, فَإِذَا نُفِخَ فِي الصُّورِ. When the trumpet is blown, فَصَعِقَ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا مَنْ شَاءَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ نُفِخَ فِيهِ أُخْرَى فَإِذَا هُمْ قِيَامٌ يَنْظُرُونَ. Everybody, first trumpet is blown, everybody dies. Those who are alive, woo, they all die. These people who are alive that day when the trumpet is going to be blown are the fussaq and the mujrimeen. The righteous people are already gone. They won't live for that long. Then again it's blown. ثُمَّ نُفِخَ فِيهِ أُخْرَى فَإِذَا هُمْ قِيَامٌ يَنْظُرُونَ. Then everybody stands up. Jannah and Naar. People are going to come up from their graves. Accountability now. Questions. You're going to be questioned. Some of the angels are going to come back to life from being dead. And this is what they're going to say. سُبْحَانَكَ اللَّهِ. Exalted you are Allah. مَا عَبَدْنَاكَ حَقَّ عِبَادَتِكَ. These are the angels that were prostrating. They will say, oh Allah, we did not worship you the way you deserve to be worshipped. Sujood. أقرب ما يكون العبد لربه وهو ساجد. The closest that a person can be to Allah is when he's in sujood, right? Even that they were in this state from the day they were created until the day of the trumpet being blown. They are angels. They don't disobey Allah. لا يعصون الله ما أمرهم ويفعلون ما يؤمرون. مع ذلك they are what? Saying to Allah, ما عبدناك حق عبادتك. We have not worshipped you the way you deserve to be worshipped. So they belittle their action. They don't see it to be much. Humans, on the other hand, becomes arrogant. Believes he should enter Jannah. He reassures himself and says, Jesus took all of my sins for me, so I'm going to enter paradise. See how shaitan plays with people's minds. So those people are going to enter the hellfire. And the way that they're going to enter the hellfire, Allah states in the ayah, سَيَدْخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ دَاخِرِينَ أَيْ صَاغِرِينَ أَذِلِّينَ Humiliated. The second ibadah that the author mentions is al-khawf, fear. And the evidence for al-khawf that the author brings is إِنَّمَا ذَلِكُمُ الشَّيْطَانِ That is shaitan. يُخَوِّفُ أَوْلِيَاءَ That is shaitan. He places fear in the people's hearts. فَلَا تَخَافُوهُمْ Don't be scared of shaitan. وَخَافُونِ فِيَ مِهِ إِن كُنْتُم مُؤْمِنِينَ If you are believers. The fear is two types. A khawf, which is khawf tabi'i, natural fear. Are you with me? A natural what? A natural fear. If a lion walked into this room right now, that's all I need to say. That's all I need to say. Some people try to go through the wall. Sah? Lion came, walked, just looked at us all. Yeah? Some people pretend to be dead way before it came. Yeah? That fear is called tabi'i, natural fear, no problem. That the fear that is for Allah is the heart running to Allah. This is specific though. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's fear is that you fear Him, but you run back to Him. The fear for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in the sharia is that you fear Him and you run to Him. Whereas everything other than Allah, when you fear it, you what? You run away from it. As for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, you run to Him, subhanAllah. This is where it becomes khawf shar'i. This is the one that ayah is talking about. فرار القلب إلى الله ذعرا وفزعا. Running back to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in state of fear and... The third ibadah is الرجاء, hope. And the evidence that the author brings is فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا Anyone who hopes to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he should come with righteous actions. The word raja in the sharia means amalul abdi bi rabbihi fi husul al maqsoodi. If somebody asks you what raja means in the sharia, it means the following. It means hoping from your Lord Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow you to attain your objective. Amalul abdi بِرَبِّهِ فِي حُصُولِ الْمَقْصُودِ To allow you to attain your objective, your goal. Is that it? مَعَ بَذْلِ الْجُهْدِ مَعَ بَذْلِ الْجُهْدِ وَحُسْنِ التَّوَكُّلِ وَحُسْنِ التَّوَكُّلِ It means that you hope from your Lord to give you the ultimate goal that you're looking for, but you are coming with hard work and reliance in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're not just sitting about and saying, Ya Rabb, give it to me. Hoping from your Lord means that you work. That's why the ayah says, فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ Anyone who hopes to meet his Lord. When it means to meet your Lord, means you want to attain Jannah from Him. What does the ayah say? فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا Come with righteous actions. The fourth ibadah that the author mentions is tawakkul. Tawakkul means إظهار العبد توكل means إظهار العبد عجزه لله واعتماده عليه إظهار العبد عجزه لله واعتماده عليه It means that the slave shows that he's very weak. He expresses weakness to his Lord. إظهار العبد that the slave expresses لله to Allah. إظهار العبد عجزه لله. The slave expresses his weakness to Allah. واعتماده عليه and he relies on him. He leans on Allah Tabaraka Ta'ala's support.